Welcome to the fan of history. I am the fan of history, and I'm just a fan of history and not an historian. But I think that everything I say here is correct, and if you find something wrong, please correct me, because, and give me your sources for that, because I want to learn. We are going to talk about the world in 800 BC, and we are going to talk about the civilizations of the world. So we'll focus more on recorded history and less on archaeology, but archaeology is of course important. But for areas without recorded history, we will skip over them or briefly mention them. The purpose with this video is to set the stage for the decade reports of the 8th century BC. I have done this for the world in 1000 BC and 900 BC. You'll find the videos on the Fan of History YouTube channel. But as you will see, the political situation is much more complicated in 800 BC. And that was why I started in 1000 BC, to give myself experience in doing this. So this is a huge show compared to the earlier ones. We don't have a world map, sadly. I only have one for 1000 BC. So I will use local maps. If you know a world map for 800 BC, please direct me that way. So what is the world like in 800 BC? Well, the greatest nation-state is the Western Su dynasty of China. We'll talk more about that. There is a lot of archaeology, as I said. A lot of knowledge comes from pottery. The world population estimate is about 65 to 70 million at this time. This is called the Archaic Age. It will last until 500 BC, and this is the last period of real ancient history. Course, you usually talk about the classic period for 500 BC onwards. This is of course very focused on Greece and Rome, and we will talk about the entire world here. This is the population centers of the world, so this is like the focus. Most people are in China, in the Middle East, or in Mexico. So let's talk about Greece. This is really the beginning of Greek history. Of course, there has been the Mycenaeans, but there was the Bronze Age collapse in the 12th century BC. And now, finally, Greece is starting to come back. And there are no great polis now, but there are some villages or small towns that are starting to grow a lot during this century. And we could mention Sparta, Athens, Corinth, Argos, Knossos on Crete, and Miletus. Those are very powerful, but there are two city-states that are a lot more important than these at this time. And those are Chalcis and Eritrea, or Lefkandi. Still debated whether Lefkandi is old Eritrea, and the finds from Eritrea are late 8th century BC. But the island of Euboea in Greece is very important. The people of Euboea are traveling the Ionian Sea, traveling the Mediterranean, going to Cyprus, and they've already founded, I talked about that in the 820s episode, they founded a colony of Almina in Syria, and they trade a lot with the Phoenicians. And it is from Euboea that writing will spread over Greece in the 8th century BC, because the Greeks cannot write. They have forgotten the art of writing, and they will get a much easier alphabet from the Phoenicians. And the island of Euboea is way ahead of mainland Greece at this point. In Italy, we have the Villanovans, and the Villanovans are about to become the Etruscans. It is not very clear when you start talking about the Etruscans or the Villanovans, but it is now proven beyond a doubt by DNA analysis in 2013, actually, that the Etruscans are the Villanovans, and that the Etruscans are native people going back maybe 5,000 years in Italy. There are other people living in Italy, including the Latins, and some of the Latins even live on the Palatine Hill, but none of them are near the state level of the Villanovans. Rome will not be founded in 753 BC. There were no children suckling wolves. And Rome will enter our narrative as an Etruscan city with some Latins in it in 616 BC. The Villanovans have come into contact with the Phoenicians mainly on Sardinia, and they are now trading stuff, but they're also trading stuff to the rest of Europe up to the Baltic Sea via the Amber Road. So this is a state level society that is going strong. In Austria we have the Hallstatt culture. These are proto-Celts, but they are not all of the proto-Celts. It's an early Iron Age culture. It developed out of the Urnfield culture. It's named for its type site Hallstatt, close to Salzburg. There are salt mines there, and the wealth and power of Hallstatt comes from the salt mines. And there will be a distinctive material culture that was spread from Hallstatt. This subject is a lot contested and complicated. There is an old model of Celtic civilization going from Hallstatt to Latene and then spreading all over Europe, but it's not that simple, and I will try to tell you the true story of the Celts in my narrative, but at this point nobody really knows. There are a lot of theories, but the Hallstatt Latene clean spread of Celtic culture, that model is out. It does not apply anymore. The Celts had no writing, so at this point, so we don't know a lot, but it's still also extremely early for Hallstatt. In the Middle East, things have been going on for thousands of years. The Neo-Assyrian Empire started in 911 BC, and we've talked a lot about the Neo-Assyrian Empire in the narrative. But the oldest state is Elam. And now I'm gonna give you my power rankings for the Middle East civilizations. Right now, in 800 BC, Assyria is still the most powerful country, followed closely by the mountain kingdom of Urartu, the proto-Armenians, pretty much. Then Elam, the Manians, Egypt, which is very weak at this time, Aram Damascus, the Medes, and Israel. We'll talk about all of them. But first we have to talk about the empire. This is the area formerly under control of the empire in 824 BC. And it sort of loosely applies right now. But the empire is in trouble. And the central authority is losing power. They have the best army in the world, they have iron weapons, they worship one god, Ashur, the god of war, but he's conveniently all gods, so if you meet someone worshiping god, it's just an aspect of Ashur. But Ashur tells the Assyrian king that you have to go out every year and beat people up, so the Assyrian royal army is gathering every year, goes out on campaign against someone, so you don't want to be on the Assyrian hit list. The king is the high priest of Ashur, and the empire has been in decline for 27 years, and the control over the west of Til Barsip, that is Syrian Anatolia, is very weak at this point, and Babylonia is in disarray. We don't even know if the Assyrians really controlled Babylonia at this time or not. The king is Adad-nirari III, and he's the sixth king of the empire. He will rule 811 to 783 BC. The resistance against the empire, the vassal states of Syria and the Mediterranean coast, are giving the empire trouble, and one state that is leading the resistance is Aram Damascus. Adad-nirari III was a warrior king. He did a lot of good things against the enemies of Assyria, but he couldn't stop the growth of powerful nobles inside Assyria and the loss of central royal authority. And the biggest example of this loss of authority is Shamshi-Ilu. He is the Turtanu, the field marshal, the commander-in-chief of the Assyrian army. And he is an Aramean. He stays in Til Barsip, the city I just showed you, and he is very much an Aramean warlord with an Assyrian royal army. He has not grown into his full power yet. He will dominate Assyria in the early 8th century BC, but right now he's actually obeying Adad-nirari III, because Adad-nirari III is a much stronger king than the kings that will follow. Babylonia then. This is southern Mesopotamia, what is today Iraq. The land has no real king. Power is split between the core of the country and two powerful barbarian tribes, the Kassites in the north who have defected, they ruled Babylonia for a long time, but now they have their own country called Namri. And they interfere a lot in Babylonian affairs. But even worse, to the south in the marches in Sealand, there are the Chaldeans. And they have three powerful kingdoms, and they also influence Babylonia a lot. There is also the Arameans. We'll talk more about the Arameans, but they live in the countryside. They sort of obey strong Babylonian kings, but if the Babylonian king is weak or is not there at all, they will do whatever they damn please. They are a little bit like orcs. This area is under heavy Assyrian influence, and it's a very dark age for Babylon, but the nation of Babylonia has been around since the 19th century BC, being founded by Hammurabi. In the Zagros Mountains, in northeastern Iraq, Iran, there are the Manians. They are non-Indo-Europeans. They have been around for a long time, but right now they have grown powerful into a powerful state. And the Medes and the Persians, mountain tribes of the Zagros Mountains and of Iran, they might be vassals to the Medes. And the Manians are the third most powerful of the big rivals around Lake Urmia. You see Lake Urmia right next to Miandoba on this map. And to the northwest are Urartu, and to the west is Assyria. So they have powerful enemies, but they are still growing stronger. And their power will peak later in the 8th century BC. There is also the mysterious kingdom of Elam. It's really old. Recent finds have said that Elam might be the oldest civilization of the world. But this is extremely contested and complicated. And it's worse because we can't read what the Elamites wrote. And very little is known of this period. Elam was matriarchal at some point. But the Elam has come out of its shell and intervened against Assyrian domination in Babylonia in 810 BC. This didn't work out very well. But from now on, Elam will be an enemy of Assyria whenever they get the chance. The southern city of Anshan, the capital is Susa to the north, but the southern city of Anshan, it's close to the mountain tribes, the Persians, for example, and it's threatened, so Elam has its own problems. Elam is also closely allied with Ilippi. Ilippi is a small kingdom, also in the Zagros Mountains, north of Elam. You can see the kingdom of Mana, that's the Manians. You have Lake Urmia to the upper north there. There are many mountain tribes in the Zagros, and the most well-known are the Medes and the Persians, but there are others as well, and they're loosely organized at this point. If you look right below the kingdom of Mana, right below to the left, you'll find Samoa. That's an ancient kingdom that has been conquered by the Assyrians, so the Assyrians have a strong presence in Samoa. And if you go a bit further south, you'll find Parsua and Namar. And Namar is the kingdom of Namri, the Kassite kingdom, the barbarian tribe that defected from Babylon. They are also enemies of the Assyrians. North of Assyria, in what is today Turkey and Armenia, is the kingdom of Urartu. It's the second most powerful state in the Near East, and they've shaped this state during the 9th century BC, and they have based it on things they've learned from the Assyrians. So this kingdom is getting more and more like Assyria, but this place is a natural fortress, and it is incredibly hard to invade. The Assyrians did so plenty of times in the 9th century BC, but Urartu still grew strong. They are conquering to the north, to the east, to the west. But in the north, in the Caucasus, they are actually reducing kingdoms that have kept the horse lords out of Mesopotamia. And we'll talk about them on the next slide. Menua is the king of Urartu. He's strong, he has built a lot, he has organized a lot, and he has conquered a lot. He will rule Urartu from 810 to 786 BC and be followed by even stronger kings. On the steppe to the north of the Caucasus are two powerful horse steppe people, the Cimmerians and the Scythians. They are Indo-European steppe nomads and they don't have anything to do with Conan. But the Scythians in the east are pressuring on the Cimmerians, so the Cimmerians will have to do something. And in 714 BC, the Cimmerians will do something that will disrupt the power structure of the Near East. In northern Syria then, we have Neo-Hittite kingdoms. These are the remains of the Hittite Empire that was destroyed in the Bronze Age collapse. They have intermingled with the Arameans. We'll talk more about the Arameans later. Assyrian power projects from Tel Barsip. As I said, you'll find Tel Barsip almost in the middle of this map. And it's being ruled by Shamshi-Ilu, the field marshal, the commander-in-chief of Assyria. But all of these states are now supposed to be vassals of Assyria. But Urartu thinks that these states should be vassals of Urartu. Arpad, which is in the middle of the map, has recently been crushed because it defied Assyria. And it will defy Assyria again. Some of these kingdoms are allied to Assyria, and most notably Hamath, which is probably what has made Hamath the most powerful of the kingdoms of Syria. The Phoenicians control a coastal strip, and that strip is very important. You see it on the lower, at the bottom of the map, Byblos and Phoenicia. In the southern Levant, we have Aram Damascus, and this is the most powerful of the Aramean states. Hazael is the king of Damascus. There has been a long, long war and hatred between Damascus and Israel. But at this point, Damascus is winning. They have made Ammon, Edom and Moab vassal states. And Hazael is a very powerful king. Judah, that you see to the lower, where Jerusalem is contested at this point, if it even exists. The historical record begins in 733 BC, but I can no longer avoid talking about Judah, so I will start talking about Judah in the 790s episode. By the southern Mediterranean coast, you have the Philistine states, and they were recently crushed by Damascus, who now have access to the sea and control all the important trade routes. So what about Israel? Israel is ruled by Jehoahaz, who is the king in Samaria. He is a follower of Yahweh, but Israel at this point is polytheistic, and he entertains a lot of pagan gods, but they've thrown out all the gods of the Phoenicians, and the Phoenician gods had a lot of influence in Israel. You might know of Baal and also Melkart. But Asherah, the Semitic mother goddess, is worshipped a lot in Israel, and especially as the wife of Yahweh. But Israel is in big trouble. They've lost territory to the Arameans, and they are praying for a savior. Please, Lord, send us someone to save Israel. Phoenicia then. Phoenicia are ancient merchant kingdoms. They've been around for a long time. They survived and actually prospered from the Bronze Age collapse. Tyre is the strongest Phoenician state, and it is possible that Tyre actually rules all of Phoenicia at this point. The Phoenicians invented their alphabet, and their alphabet is spreading all over the Middle East because the Phoenician alphabet is very easy to learn compared to the old archaic languages of Assyria and Babylonia. But the Phoenicians write down everything on papyrus, and papyrus does not last, so we have very little in the way of Phoenician inscriptions, and that is why we know surprisingly little about Phoenicia. But at this point, they have been subjected to Assyrian power several times, and they've gotten out of it in their old method. When a powerful empire appears, the Phoenicians sell them stuff. They provide luxury goods that no one else can provide, and they get this stuff from the Mediterranean. So in order to placate the Assyrians, there has been an aggressive wave of colonization of the Mediterranean, coming mainly from Tyre. And this is just to be able to pay the Assyrians. But the Phoenicians are growing stronger as well because of this colonization wave. And their most famous colony is no doubt Carthage. We don't have any sources for the whole century from Carthage. It is traditionally founded in 814 BC. I dedicated a whole episode to this. It could still be ruled by the founding queen, Dido. It has strong connections to Tyre. And this is very early in Carthage history. It's not the most important Phoenician colony yet, because they have important colonies on Cyprus, in Spain, and on Sardinia. Egypt is a mess in 800 BC. There are three pharaohs, and there are a couple of independent war chiefs that don't listen to the pharaohs. Everyone who has any power in Egypt this time is of Libyan descent, but they are really... they have become Egyptians. They think like Egyptians. But they honor their Libyan descent. Shoshenq III is the pharaoh of the delta of the north. If you go south from the delta, you come to Heracleopolis, which is a later name for this city. It's named something else in 800 BC. And there Ossokon III is the pharaoh. And then you go south to the important city of Thebes, and there Pedubas I rules as probably the most powerful pharaoh of this era. In the delta, there is also closer to the Libyan border, there are the great chiefs of the Ma and the great chiefs of the Libu, and they are Libyan princes that don't listen to Shoshenq III. They might like pay lip service to him, but they don't really obey him. This is the third intermediate period, and it's a sad time for Egypt. It's a backwater. They don't have iron to make iron weapons. Everybody else have iron weapons. But they do have the natural wealth of the Nile River. Four times a year you get amazing rich crops from the Nile. And it's also very hard to invade Egypt. So that's why Egypt can go on despite being so weak. There are several dynasties around, and we're not going to go into those because it's the 25th dynasty that will end this mess. And there is a threat to Egypt because south of Egypt is the old state of Kush. The new kingdom used to rule Kush, but the new kingdom is way gone. It hasn't been around. Egyptian power has been weak. And two times in the 10th century BC, Kush have invaded Egypt, and they might just do so again. So, here is something entirely new. We had the first mention of the Arabs at the Battle of Karkar in 853 BC, but there are ancient kingdoms on the coast of the Arabian Peninsula. One of them is Dilmun. Dilmun is mentioned very early in the Sumerian sources, and it had its glory period in 2000 to 1700 BC. It's still around, but we only have secondary sources. Archaeology in this area is new, and we hope that they find interesting stuff. But Dilmun is a very ancient kingdom. Saba in Yemen has its capital in Marib. When the Romans come around, they will call this Arabia Felix. Saba controls important spice trade and exported this far and wide, maybe even as far as India. And they also have close contact with the kingdom of Dumt in Ethiopia. So Saba is on both sides of the Red Sea. And Magan is an ancient trading partner of the Sumerians, assumed to be located in Oman. I don't know anything about Muscat. And there are other tribes and kingdoms of the Arabian coast that are also not well known, at least to me. So the Arameans, I mentioned them several times. They invaded the Middle East during the Bronze Age collapse. And they have been very strange because they do not often build cities, but they live in the countryside and harass people. And they are indirectly responsible for the rise of the Assyrian Empire by pressuring the Assyrians into becoming awesome. But the Assyrians have integrated a lot of Arameans, and you can see that by the power of Shamshi-Ilu, he is an Aramean. Babylonia is full of Arameans, and they are sometimes integrated and sometimes wild and crazy. The best integration happened in Syria and Anatolia, where the Neo-Hittite kingdoms impressed the Arameans into service, and they have merged kind of with the Arameans. The only Aramean-only kingdom that is of note is Aram Damascus, but some of the kingdoms in southern Syria are also mainly Aramean. And the Arameans will influence our culture a lot, and mainly because their language, is extremely easy to learn compared to the ancient languages. And it's now combined with the Phoenician alphabet, so now it's easy to write as well. So people will start talking Aramean, Aramean will become like the common tongue. It will later pose a danger to the ancient languages. And there is a reason that Jesus Christ actually spoke Aramean, and it's because this language is so easy that it spread like wildfire. In Asia Minor, this is early for Asia Minor, and it's actually not quite well known what's going on in Asia Minor. But there's a lot of Greek settlement on the Ionian coast, and they have been around for a long time. Miletus, as I said, is one of the powerful Greek city-states. The Carians and the Lycians, right to the right of Miletus, they are very influenced by the Greeks, and they will become like pseudo-Greeks, sort of like the Macedonians. Phrygia and Lydia will become important kingdoms later on in our story. And I just have to mention the hill tribes of Mysia, because they refuse to build cities and they love to beat up everybody who builds cities nearby. So the Mysians are a nuisance. Cyprus is mainly Greek, except for one Phoenician colony, one very important Phoenician colony controlled by Tyre. In India, Panchala is the most powerful kingdom. It's the Vedic era, but the Upanishads are starting to be composed. So early ideas of Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism are taking form. But the Indians can't write at this time, so everything comes down to us from oral memory. And this is a problem, so we don't know a whole lot about India. And the Indian dating of things is very, very ambitious. Things are like 27 million years old. So you can't really take most of it at face value. The Western Zhou state of China then. This is the biggest nation state of the world. Its capital is Fengao, Haojing. It's ruled by King Chuan. He will rule from 827 to 782 BC. His father was arrested for being a tyrant, so King Chuan has been trying to rule fairly, but the nobles have gained too much power, and the different kingdoms of the Zhou Empire, so the Zhou kingdom itself is very small, and it has controlled the other kingdoms for a long time, but now this is all falling apart, and the Western Zhou will be invaded by barbarians in 771 BC. But the Zhou dynasty is the longest ruling dynasty in China. It will be around for 800 years. In Africa, we have the Bantu expansion. And the Bantu expansion has something to do with Nigeria, because in Nigeria there is the Nok culture. So earlier, southern Africa was ruled by the Khoisan, or not ruled, but the Khoisan were living, and they are now being pushed back by the Bantu language group. It's possible that the Bantu have agriculture, while the Khoisan do not. Nobody has iron until 400 BC, and there are no great states for 2000 years here. So, we have the Lapita culture. They are seafaring, they are the proto-Polynesians, they are going around over the Pacific. They do not find New Zealand, but they have small ragged canoes and go around on these very dangerous waters. And I like to mention them, the New Zealand and Madagascar have not seen Homo sapiens occupation yet. In Mexico, we have the amazing civilization of the Olmecs. This is the second major civilization that have started in the New World. They write things down, but we can't read them. They have amazing art, and they are definitely the center of the world they know. They have ritual bloodletting, but they probably don't have human sacrifice. The religion is centered around the jaguar, and they are most famous for their gigantic heads that represent Olmec rulers. They do not have the wheel. They are centered on La Venta. They just started building pyramids. And they are no longer the only state in the New World. There is the Poverty Point culture is not really a nation state in North America. We talked about that in the 930s episode. The Maya are around. They have been around for a long, long time. They just got started their first statelet, La Blanca, on the Pacific coast. They are migrating into the lowlands, and if you look at the southern Maya area here, that's about where La Blanca is located. They have their base in the Yucatan, and they grow beans, maize, chili peppers, and squash. They are heavily influenced by the Olmec, and they live in awe of the Olmecs. In Peru, we have Chavín culture. They do not have writing, sadly. That's so sad, but they create fantastic art, and they seem to have no violence. They don't have a lot of weapons, they don't have walls, there is no sign of war. They're ruled by shaman priests, and they inspire other cultures nearby to become like them. The religion is focused around jaguars, and they take drugs and transform into jaguars. So they are peaceful, they take drugs, and they are into new age stuff. So yes, they are hippies. So, if I missed your culture, if you think, what about my area? It's probably because there is nothing I knew about it. But if you know something, please tell me. Follow this YouTube channel, because I will do the decade reports for the 8th century BC. There will probably be 1 to 3 parts for each decade. I found that 15 to 20 minutes is the optimal length for one of these videos. Highlights of the 8th century BC then. The dog people will have their revenge. Back in the 10th century BC, King Mu of Zhou China crushed the dog people, but now they're back. The Greeks will start colonizing the Mediterranean. A lot. There will be the Olympic Games. I will start doing sport reports. And the Assyrian Empire will look like it is falling apart. But then one man appears. One man so terrible that his enemies will often refer to him just as the Assyrian. Please discuss the show with me on YouTube or on Facebook. Check out our webpage, fanofhistorywordpress.com. We're trying to make this into podcast as well, and you can hopefully find us on iTunes when this goes live on YouTube. Subscribe, like, and share these videos, because that helps us keep going. And thank you so much for watching.